Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Well, good afternoon. Good afternoon. Thank you for being here. And it's nice to have that reel of pictures done, so I don't hear any more comments about the long and lustrous hair, etc. But it means so much to us that you've come today. I have a lot of special guests here that span our 38 years of ministry. And one that goes back the farthest is my good friend John Gerhart. We met in our South Minneapolis church in 1986. Two churches later, my music director, Diane Wallman, and I had nothing to do with the planning of this entire thing, except I demanded that I could sing this song, which, honestly, John played for my ordination in 1990, so we have done this before, and Diane and I, it's my tribute, and it really says it all. Can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you give to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude, all that I am and ever hope to be. I owe it all to thee. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. Saved me with his power, he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Just let me live my life and let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And if I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. With his blood, he has saved me. With his power, he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done.
Thank you. That was Diane Wallman, who is here with her husband, Eric, and we welcome them. We welcome all of you today. Thank you for coming as we celebrate the life and the ministry of Chris Holk along with Kathleen Holk. They have been very, very important in the lives of every single one of us, and we're so grateful to God for them. And we have some out-of-town guests we want to, first of all, recognize. And if you folks would stand and just wave, and if the rest of you would hold your applause till they've all been introduced, all right? Otherwise, we're going to be here till 6 o'clock. So first of all, we want to introduce Bob Dahl. Bob is the CEO of Cassia Life. If it wasn't for Bob, we wouldn't have this property, this campus. We're so grateful for that. We want to introduce Fritz Dale. He is the retired Reach National Director for the Evangelical Free Church, now living in Wisconsin. And if it wasn't for Fritz, I wouldn't have gotten to know Chris, and I wouldn't be here as the associate pastor. So Janelle, is Janelle here? Janelle Jaw? They're en route. Okay, all right. She's a good friend that they met in 2008 on an English Language Institute mission trip to teach English in China. And then we have family here, Brent and Jessica Holk, son and wife, and their daughters Sloan and Reese. So they're here. And another son, Josh. Liz couldn't join with him, but there's a young lady besides Josh. So we welcome you. Then Laura. That's Laura. Oh, that's who that is. That's Josh's sister. All right. Roger and Pat Holk. Is there a Roger and Pat Holk? This is Chris's brother and his wife. They are retired, living in Rotunda, West Florida. Leland and Kathy Schmidt. Leland was the associate pastor at Faith Church in Spirit Lake, Iowa with Chris. Now he's the lead pastor in Richmond Center, Wisconsin. Glenn and Karen Schreiber. Glenn is the retired Southeastern District Superintendent, and his relationship with Chris goes back 30 years to when Glenn was the founder of Urban Impact in New Orleans. Dwayne and Diane Shirk, I got that right? He was baptized this morning by Pastor Chris. They are college friends. He claims that he knew first that Chris would go into ministry. Was that before even Chris knew that? Wow, okay. And then we have Paul and Kari Stewart. Paul was the youth pastor at Faith Evangelical Free Church in Austin, Minnesota, and they now live in Jacksonville. And then last but not least, we want to introduce John and Wendy Gerhardt. And you've already met John, but John's going to come out, and he has a special presentation. So now you can all applaud for all these wonderful people.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Enough about being nice. Isn't that right, Josh? Yeah, I was talking to Josh and Brent, and they were talking about how they got a lot of stuff pent up from the years. So simmer down, boys. But we're excited. Today is going to be a great journey of not just here at Live Oaks, but a journey through a 38-plus year history of ministry and how Chris moved from Paulina through Ted's back to Minneapolis, to Austin, to Spirit Lake, to Colorado Springs, to a stint in China, and then that got him all ready to come here to be at Live Oaks. And there's only one person that can handle all of that, that can MC that and do that, and our MC for this evening is Mr. Paul Stewart. Come on up, Paul.
Thank you, John. Am I on? Did I turn that on right? Check. There we go. I've been out of ministry for a while. I don't know how these things work. I'm just a caveman. Thank you so much. Such an honor to be here tonight to honor Chris and Kathleen. I really had to work through the Kathleen because she was always just Chris and Kathy to me. And so, Kathleen, I got it right. As you guys all know, that Chris is an amazing storyteller. He can tell stories with the best of them, if not the best. And tonight, we are so excited to have that opportunity to tell some stories about him and Kathleen and the ministry things that go on. I know I have a slew of them. Only half of them are allowed, maybe, but we're going to try to do our best to do that. But with that said, I want to invite Chris and Kathleen on up to the stage here, and we have some special gifts for you to come on up as we chat with you guys.
Love you.
Be nice.
Well, we cannot guarantee anything, but we do want to honor you guys tonight and have that opportunity to celebrate all these amazing years of ministry. 38 years. That's, you know, wow. It's pretty awesome. Just a couple years more than I'm old, so that's pretty cool too, you know. No, but it is pretty awesome. I'm going to invite up Wendy Gearhart. You're going to bring up some flowers for Kathleen. And I think Rich, nope, not yet. Oh, not doing that yet. Okay. Put them on the flowers here. You can read the card later. I'm sure it has, like, you know, fun stuff in there too. That'd be good. So tell us a little bit, you know, here, I'm going to give you guys a microphone here. Just, what were your expectations coming into today? I mean, this is a big deal. This is a big thing. You know, a lot of things to celebrate, but what are you worried about tonight?
Well, for 12 years, I've been planning things, and I had no control over this or you. So as much as I am so excited and grateful for our friends to be here, I'm just slightly nervous about what will be said.
Okay, yeah. And I'm cautiously optimistic for you. That'll be good. Rich Eaton, we have a special gift for you guys. They're coming up with something to commemorate. As we all know, we're not saying goodbye to Chris and Kathleen, but we're saying see you later. See you in a little while. And so.
We'd like to have you guys open this.
Yeah, you need to open this one. Yeah.
Carefully. This is to remind you what you used to look like. There's this.
I see the proportions are perfect.
Yeah, right.
It's a bobblehead.
Chris, this is also to remind you of what's coming in the future here. So when you open this, please take the tissue off the top and then take the reach way down and grab it way down. Well, no, way down. Way down. Okay. Chris is going to be semi-retired. So this is to remind him that he's semi-retired, and that picture that we just gave Kathleen is right here on the front. And then on the back, as you're going down the road, it says, if you're not dead, you're not done. So that everybody understands that he's not done. Semi-retired. Congratulations.
Well, thank you. Thank you. It's unexpected.
I'll give you a thank.
You're welcome.
Rich. All right. Thank you, Rich. Big round of applause for them. Well, let's let the festivities keep moving here. This is the part you probably start sweating. But I'm going to invite John Gearhart, Glenn Schreiber, and Bob Dahl up to the stage. Yeah, big round of applause. We got a few microphones for you guys here. Bob, I'm going to put you down there on that corner. Glenn, you get to be in the middle, and John will put here because I need to keep close watch on him. So that was my instructions.
Yes, sir.
Okay. There you go, sir. Well, let's start with this. You guys have all probably know bits and pieces about these three men over here. But why don't we start out just how you guys ended up first meeting Chris and Kathleen and first impressions when you first met them.
Do you remember the very first time we met?
Came looking for a job.
Yeah, I remember it vividly. I remember it vividly. You asked for money. Yep. And we were connected through Dave Keel, who met you at a district conference, a Free Church district conference. Dave Keel was the head chaplain at Elam Care, now Cassia. And he came back from it and he said, I ran into a pastor at this conference that I think you should meet. He's got a real passion for serving older adults and especially church ministry for older adults. And he wants to meet you. And I said, he said, the only thing you need to know is he's from Iowa. And I said, despite that, I think we should go ahead and meet. And we met.
That was big of you.
And we went out to a restaurant. But before we did, you Chris and Kathleen came to the Elam office, he comes in the door and he introduces Kathleen. Now I don't know if you have this, but when I'm talking like right now, this is my outside voice, but I have an inside voice that just never stops chattering. And my outside voice has a pretty good filter on it. My inside voice has no filter. So when we had set up getting together, the impression was it's just going to be Chris and we're going to go out to meet. And Kathleen comes along and he says, here's Kathleen. My outside voice says, great to meet you, Kathleen. I'm looking forward to meeting you. My inside voice is, he didn't say anything about bringing his wife. He's from Iowa. That's really weird.
How about
we're a package deal.
So, Chris, I like that first question. Do you remember when we first met?
I think we were playing golf in Minneapolis, is my recollection.
But my recollection was 1986. You were the youth pastor at that point early on. You were coming back from youth mission team. And we were planning our second church in the Louisville area. We had just begun on the Indiana side. And you That's called right. and said, hey, we're coming back through. I heard about you. Can my team help you do something? And so you spent that evening spent that day with us. And we flyered out, I don't know how many hundreds of houses with your team, letting them know about our new church plan. So that's when I first met you.
Yeah, that's right.
And then maybe we'll get back to the follow-up from that.
Awesome. All right, John. So we'll give John a little bit more leeway here. He's got some slides and some different things, but John, why don't you give us a little bit?
Well, like Bob, I met you when I asked for money, when I was begging at the corner. And Isaac, if you could roll a few slides. I just needed some audiovisual to help me with this.
Paulina proud.
So we have the man that made Paulina proud. So he went from playing a trumpet in the band to being a part of farming with his dad and then going to Iowa State and going to the farmhouse and meeting Kathleen and then working for the
Federal Land Bank
or something like that, right? And went there and then went to Ted's and then came back and was a farmer. And the day that Josh was born, the soybean trailer tipped over and it ended his career as a farmer. And we can all thank God for that. And then from there to First Free and then other things. And then the other thing is my theme today is that Chris Hulk, fashion diva.
Yeah, colorful bow ties are
timeless. No. Remember, you're not in control. This is my turn. So within that, I had an insider send me pictures and how many bow ties you had, many of them, and how he collected presidential campaign buttons. But one of the things I can attest to growing up and when they were in Minneapolis is that the boys wanted Zubas. You remember that, guys? Mm. And being a poor youth pastor, they couldn't afford them, so Kathy made some homemade Zubas. And I got a couple gifts for you all, but Chris, this one's for you. I picked out this bag specifically.
Okay.
He has got his own Minnesota Vikings Zuba shorts. Because you can say it with me now, Chris Hulk, fashion diva. Not only that, you can see his mode of transportation has changed over the years. And who needs a golf cart when you have a motorcycle? And we took one trip as when I was a volunteer with him in the youth group, and we were going from Minneapolis to Flagstaff, Arizona. But Chris prided himself in making sure the trips were as inexpensive so as many kids could come. And so we went to Flagstaff, Arizona from Minneapolis via Rapid City, South Dakota. So if I wish I had a map, but we pulled into Rapid City, we're at Rainbow Ranch, and then the next morning we got up to leave and we had to go from Rapid City to Santa Fe, New Mexico in one day. And I've looked at Chris and I'm like, well, what's going on? And here's Chris's answer. It's only that far on the map. And I politely looked at my leader and said, are you using a globe? But he did that, was a part of that. And then we have a big stage here, but he was ready for the big stage in Paulina. Is that bye-bye birdie? Is that what?
Bye-bye birdie.
Bye-bye birdie.
Albert.
And if you think about it, though, for many of us, as we look back at our past, there are many things that God put in our path that prepared us for what we do. And you look at those things in Chris's life that we're kind of making fun of them and having fun at your expense, that really was a big part of that. And then, Kathy, I didn't want you to feel left out. If I can get the next slide, we got to see this one right here. Oh, baby. I don't know if any of you know that Chris and Kathleen kind of like the Iowa State Cyclones. I don't know if you know that. But you know, they're going to have some free time to go to some games. And since he is a fashion
diva,
Kathleen and Chris, before I end, I got one last thing, but here, I'd like you to take out your gift for you guys to go to games together in.
Oh. I can see it.
So,
wrong size.
One size fits all. There. And you call yourself a fashion diva, right? But I need a few of you all that hang with them. I want some pictures, amen? And anybody gets them in the church, I'll give you $10, all right? But then I'd like to end with this. If you could move to the next slide, please. There are friends that stick closer than brothers and sisters. In my life, there are three people that really have had major influence on me, and they're all here today. It's my wife, it's Glenn, and it's you. And you, Kathleen, on our family and everything else. Chris, how you taught me how to be a leader, how to be persistent, what vision was about. You're the best shepherder I've ever seen. And how you remember people and how you care for people, your vision for Come to the Light, your vision for this place, and how you relentlessly do that. So, yeah, we joke about a lot of stuff, my friend, but I, like probably everybody else in this room, are better people. I'm a better man because I have you as my best friend. And so we thank you and praise you for that.
Well, Glenn, do you want to follow up on that too?
I do. So it was in 1986, in the first early part of that year, the mid part of the year, that you took the initiative and you called me up and asked if your team could come by and help us with our church plant. It was later in that year that I did go to Minneapolis for some national meetings, happened to be meeting at First Free there, where you were then an associate pastor. You had a new youth pastor that came on board, and you took the initiative there, and you said, hey, you need to meet this guy. So introduced me to John. We had just moved to New Orleans. We were just getting started, and we knew that it was going to be, we were down there on an island. No one in the Free Church was even in that area. And I knew that youth pastors and their teams, because of what I learned from you earlier in that year, were to be of help. So you introduced me to John. John, you ended up being the first mission team to come to New Orleans to help us launch that ministry. God got a hold of you there, and then we've been partners ever since from that. And so, Chris, thank you for putting us together, and then the three of us here have, for years, have been a part of those continued mission teams, even this past week, a part of just continuing to keep ministry going and vibrant. Then I took this position as a superintendent down here in the Southeast, and you had started a ministry called Encore. I got a call from Bill and Mary Ann Hicks about a ministry idea that they had about launching a church here in the Villages. The first person I thought to call was Chris. Thank you. Gave you that call and said, hey, would you come to the Villages? Let me introduce you to Bill and Mary Ann. Hear their heart. Come scout out the Villages. I think I need your expertise to help see what we do with this. And you have done more than that. In fact, we didn't initially think of you as being the pastor, but God had different plans and he moved it. So we have had quite a journey together, and I thank God for you. You're an IT specialist. You're an initiative taker. You see things that need to be done, and you don't mind just jumping in and getting those things done, and you're leaving a lot of the rest of us much better for it. So I praise God, thank God for the two of you and the journey we've been on, and just look what God has done. To God be the glory. And I do remember when we had started Castle Rock Community Church there in New Orleans, and you got up and you sang. I remember looking at the camera going, and he sings too. I had no idea. And so that was amazing. So it's been fun. And I don't think we're done yet. I think there's some more initiatives that will be taking place in these next years to come.
Not done. Thank you.
All right, Bob, it's your turn. You got a little slideshow and some things also. Why don't you share with us?
Yeah, so my history with Chris and Kathleen really starts with that Encore initiative. And that's why they came to meet me that day when he brought his wife along, didn't tell me. And so we go out for lunch, and Chris starts telling me about, you know, I've got this brand new, and by the way, can you bring up this? I've got some slides that we're going to just go through real quickly here. There we go. So we go out for lunch, and he's telling me about this passion that they have just arrived at in this point in their ministry life. And it's about just a passion for older adults in ministry, specifically trying to get the church more engaged and more intentional about a ministry for older adults. And he said, I went to the National Office of the Free Church, and they were interested in it, and they said they'd give me some funding, operative word being some, and he said, but we're here today to see if, and this is where my internal voice, no filter, said, uh-oh. He said, we're looking for some additional funding to make this project work. And then my internal voice said, and that's why Blondie's along with them. She's the closer here.
Nailed it.
Yeah. It really wasn't a hard sell. Our organization has been serving older adults. We're affiliated with the Evangelical Free Church, and we agreed to fund what became the Encore program for 3 years of funding. And go ahead, Isaac. So we start. Chris and Kathleen start organizing this encore program, and he calls one day and he said, you know, I'm putting together an advisory team of folks that will help, and we're going to have some meetings, maybe twice a year at different locations. Would you like to be on it? Internal voice says, duh, got to watch this investment we're making here, right? And we end up, you can go back to that slide, Isaac, we end up at the encore, this meeting at the Hicks's house, Bill and Marianne's house. This is taken on the lanai in March of 2011. And this is the time, it was in this time period, I believe, where you really solidified your interest in ministry here, and you planted your stake here and said, we're going to do this. We're going to try and start a church here and go forward. When I, after these meetings, Chris put together a summary, and this is taken from his summary newsletter that he put together. And inside voice when I saw that, is it, does he always have that bewildered look on his face? I don't know. From here, I'm going to fast forward to the journey of Live Oaks. We were invited, we being Elam and Cassia, were invited to become part of this journey, and we agreed to it. And so we started to look for land and property that we could build this joint campus together. And we found this 25-acre parcel land that we're sitting on today. By God's grace, the Leatherman family decided to sell it to us, and we got it under contract. And we needed to start work on a master plan for the site. And one day I got a call from Chris, and he said, I was just so inspired this last week. I've been thinking about the site plan and our joint ministry on this 25-acre parcel. And he said, I started drawing. Inside brain goes, uh-oh. And he said, I want to send you what I've come up with. And this is what I got. Do you remember that?
I do. I like it.
I got it. Inside voice said, what the bleep is that? No filter. Remember, I'm sorry. No filter. He calls me. He said, did you get it? He's all excited. And I said, yeah, I got it. He said, what'd you think? I said, I don't know what to say. I said, it's really blue. I said, it's funny, Chris, that we're on the same wavelength here, because I've been thinking about what this master plan might look like that we work on. In fact, just a few days ago, I bought a computer program. I put it on my computer, I can draw with it. And let me show you what I've got, what I came up with, and see what you think. By the way, I've been asked 100 times today. I was here for service earlier. I've been asked, I think, 100 times today, when is the next phase coming? And I know there's a gaping hole in that master plan right now. We're working on it, but we can be praying for lower interest rates. That would make a big difference. And by the way, I noticed today, I don't know if you guys know this, you got a parking problem. And I'm surprised, Chris, that you haven't mentioned it to me. And I think we should talk, because I think we can make some land available for some additional parking. And I think we can. Last slide, Isaac. Chris and Kathleen, from all of us at Cassia, thank you for inviting us on this journey. Congratulations on 38 years of ministry. You've been passionate about God's kingdom and serving God's people. Thanks for letting us be part of that journey with you. My inside voice says, I love you. Diane and I are grateful that you have allowed us to be friends and in relationship with you. We've loved our time together. God bless you. And I know that as you start this new journey in your life, you're going to continue to play hard, pray hard, and finish well. Thanks.
Good drawing.
this is a time in the program where we get a little nervous, because there's nothing harder, maybe in talking about how great somebody is that the words from your kids. So probably be a lot of tears. You guys got tissue up here? I'm gonna invite Brent, Josh, and Laura up here. They started preparing their speeches months ago and ready for this. I had the great pleasure of being their youth pastor in Austin, Minnesota, and not only did we have some amazing times together, we also got to do life together. And Chris and Kathy were, you know, for a young couple like Kari and I with little kids, were just really the role models for us to say, this is how we want to raise our kids also. The three of these wonderful people here are just a joy to my life, and we want to give them an opportunity to, what do you say to your dad when he's retiring? We're going to find out. Yeah, so you guys got microphones right next to you. Here, I'm going to give, there you go, Josh. So I guess I'm going to, do I start with the youngest or the oldest, I guess? Yeah? All right, Laura, you get to take the floor.
Well, this is very exciting, and I'm so happy that all three of us can be here. It's really awesome to see all of you guys, and I want to thank you for coming to support my parents. I'm going to keep my third child piece short and sweet, but I'm so proud of both of you, and I really look up to you for different reasons, as we kind of talked about a little bit at lunch today. It was really special. And then it is wild to think that it's 38 years. I'm coming upon my 37th birthday, and I'm like, wow, you've been doing this for my entire existence. And you know, they've talked a little bit about how you are on the farm and have done a few different careers, but then to think of having two young kids, a baby on the way, and starting a brand new career, that's like really, really amazing. And I look up to you for doing that. And then one, you know, quick little story, I guess I would say, is like, the one question I always would get was, what is it like to be a pastor's kid? People always thought we kind of grew up in this very weird, different household. And I always was just like, it's easy. They don't put pressure on us. They let us be us. And, you know, I definitely threw you guys for some curveballs. There was a time when I was like, I'm moving to New York City. Caught them all by surprise, but these two supported me and allowed me to follow my dreams, which I clearly have dreamers as parents. And so I'm really proud of you guys, and I'm so thankful to be here to celebrate this with both of you.
Awesome. All right, Joshy. You might not
hot
be
mic.
On.
There we go. You can get that one, Brent. That's how it works. All right.
You just have to turn it on, buddy.
Yeah. It's a big IT guy.
That's what happens to us middle kids. We don't know how to turn, you know, what's that?
Yeah, exactly. I'm a peacemaker. That maybe is the role I play in our family. All right, I wrote down some things because I'm afraid I will get emotional and then I'll just stop talking. So if I do stop talking, I hand off to Brent. The rest of it was awesome. I'll post it online or something. So I'm going to read this and look away from you guys maybe a little bit to get through it. So deciding what to say today was difficult. There are so many stories and memories. As a 10-year-old, I remember my dad telling me my cat died, followed by Happy April Fool's Day. Not cool, Dad. I remember as well my dad helping that same 10-year-old do a paper route early Sunday mornings in the dark, cold Minnesota winter, uphill both ways. Good job, Dad. And by the way, Mom was helping Brent with his paper route. Those Zubas didn't buy themselves. Instead of telling more stories, I want to focus on my parents' time in ministry. In 1 Peter 5, Peter says, I have a special concern for you church leaders. I know what it's like to be a leader in on Christ's suffering as well as the coming glory. Peter knew all too well that being a leader is hard. Being a church leader is much harder. And what Peter didn't know is being the wife of a church leader is the hardest. My mom and dad aren't perfect, nor is our family, but they have demonstrated what Eugene Peterson wrote about, which is a long obedience in the same direction. This long obedience to Jesus, to each other, and to their family has made it possible to have a day of celebration like this. I'm proud of my parents and love them both for who they are. In many ways, I'm a combination of my parents, and I see that more and more as I get older. Personally, I've taken on four words as core values. Those words are vision, passion, discipline, and risk. And I borrow those from a pastor and author, John Tyson, and those words just really resonated with me. And I just continued to write those down, think about them, and this is in the last 3 to 5 years, and it occurred to me, my dad has modeled those core values my entire life. These values have been central to his time at LOCC, and I believe they will serve you well in your next chapter. This next chapter is hard to imagine. As Laura was saying, I can only think of my dad as a pastor, even though he was first in banking and then an average, at best, farmer. You took a big risk at 30 to follow a calling to ministry. I can speak for a lot of people and myself and say we're glad you did. Frederick Buechner defined vocation as the place where your deep gladness and the world's hunger meet. I'd say that again, it's the place where your deep gladness and the hunger meet. That sounds like a good description for Pastor Chris Hulk. My advice for the next chapter, play hard, pray hard, and finish well.
Nice job. You made it through the whole thing. I'm so proud of you, son. we got a little settled in here now. I'm going to invite Rich Wells up. He's got a little gift for... we're going
to
come back to Brett. We're settled in. We're going to give you just a little break here. Collect your... I know you probably... You got really emotional
this
when Josh was speaking.
This is the family dynamic.
So.
I don't ever get to do anything, do I?
Yep. Oh, here you go. I'm sorry. You're good. Yeah, I think it's on. Nope, sorry. There you go.
Well, he told me all I needed to do was turn it on.
Well, you're old, Rich.
Hello. So, over the past 7 years, we've had numerous opportunities to go out to dinner with you. And one of the things we've discovered, as you kids probably well know, is that Chris loves salads. I mean, all kinds of salads. And so just like a fine boxed wine, I found a salad in a box that I think you're going to enjoy. So Chris, here you go. We'd like you to open it. I brought a X-Acto.
They taped a razor blade to it for you.
So you can just
handle with care.
Cut it open, yep.
That's the same scalpel your dermatologist just used.
I think this is going to be a salad that he's going to enjoy for quite some time. And I want you to hold it up so they can get a good picture of it and then read it, what's on the front of it.
All right, Chris's salad bar. Chocolate is made from the cocoa bean. Beans are vegetables. Vegetables are in salads. Therefore, this is salad. 100% vegetarian. That's my style. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, Rich. All right, Brett, we give you enough time to kind of emotionally, you know, after Josh's speech.
Well, I've got some bones to pick.
All right, my friend, the floor is all yours.
No, we're not going to air our grievances here. So, I have a tendency to ramble, so I do have some stuff prepared here. But I'll go back, and it was probably about a year ago now. We were down here visiting. I remember Dad and I were going to play golf, and we're on the golf cart. He's talking about, I think it's potentially lining up. This is going to be a possibility that I could retire-ish. Don't know what that means. I'm looking at him. You can see a little bit of trepidation or just wonder of how is this going to work, you know, to start to imagine those things. And so I listened, which I don't do a very good job of in life, but I was doing it at that point, and just letting him talk, and he kind of looks at me and says, you know, what do you think? And I said, so am I taking over the family business?
Sorry, James.
No,
my successor.
I said, few stipulations. I work from home and I don't work weekends. And so he said, I don't think this is going to be a good fit. So you are welcome, James. So yes, I prepared stuff here that I'm going to read. I usually don't do that, but in honor of my parents and trying to make sure that my words are tight and concise and accurate, I'm going to do that. So here we go. This part I wrote down because words matter, and I'm not going to let myself ramble, which I've been known to do. This isn't a retirement party to me. It's a chance to remember what got you here and experience those that influenced you, cheered you on, and sat with you during your journey. I expect they will do the same thing with you during your next stage of life. Retirement is getting retired from our vocabulary today. Your destiny isn't to spend the last portion of your life taking it easy and saying I've earned the ability to play golf when I want, pickleball when I want, happy hour when I want. You dedicated a lifetime to swimming upstream. You're dreamers, adventurers, builders, and helpers. I've never once bragged about what my parents did for a living or what new thing they got. We also didn't get a lot of new things, so that was pretty easy. I tell my friends about the chances you took that most people thought were crazy or unwise. I talk about parents whose dedication to each other led them down paths that made no sense to most people. I won't ever know all the details of how you got to this place in your life. I'm not you guys. And that's what makes it fun. What I do know is my parents opted into what God brought them, even though it was sometimes scary. Would I have my children spend Thanksgiving in the inner city of New Orleans compared to a nice suburban house? I'd like to think I would. I care about people, but I haven't. I've examined my childhood a lot over the last 5 years. No parents get it all right. That's God's plan. In its best form, we get to have parents who love us, but also show us how broken humans are. They expose us to life and hope they have guided us enough to fill in the blanks. You two are on the earth to push boundaries and are prepared for your swan song. My pride in my parents doesn't come from job titles, big houses, bank accounts, or a new boat. It comes from two people who said, the hell with what everyone thinks. This is what God has for us, and we have to say yes. The ups and downs of those decisions are littered throughout your life. The chapter as a pastor and a pastor's wife may be coming to a close, but there is more work out in front of you now. Don't stop being all those things that make up who you are. Get curious about what life can bring you when you're not grinding over a sermon on Friday or exhausted on a Sunday afternoon. One of my good friends reminds me of this often. There is no growth in comfort. You too now get the opportunity to finally practice what you preach. If you're not dead, you're not done. Thank you, guys. I'm going to say one more thing quick. Yeah. I'm going to say one more quick. You can give me hugs, too. All right. I think on our behalf, too, we want to thank all of you guys and a lot more people that aren't here because they don't get to do anything they've done in life without you guys. I think that's very obvious. And I think watching my parents, especially in the last 12 years, being able to excel at a time when a lot of maybe your kids have seen this or friends have seen this, when you start to go what is it going to look like for our parents as they grow older and things do slow down and change. But my parents started to thrive even more. And I think having that catapult in their life has made a difference that we believe and see well beyond they're done. And the two kids that I have here, and I know their kids see the same thing, is what models to have of to just keep going and energy and care for other people. And they get to model it all the time. So thank you on behalf of your kids. We'll talk to you about all the bad stuff in private. Don't worry about it.
All right, I'm going to invite up Donna Wells and Marianne Klagel. Here we go, Marianne.
Thank you.
I'm going to swing around this way. There we go. Should be on.
Is it on?
Yep. Yeah.
So I have had the privilege of knowing this woman for more than 20 years. Try not to get emotional. But I still call you Kathy, don't I, from our good old Spirit Lake days.
Amen. Come on, yep. Marianne. Here we go.
My world's
yep. Well, we were living in Spirit Lake when you guys arrived to pastor the church there, the E-Free Church, and we quickly became friends. In fact, we left the Catholic Church to join them at the E-Free Church, and our friendship continued. I got to see what a beautiful servant of God that you are. Yeah. So, of course, it was hard for us when God took you away from Spirit Lake. He had other plans for you. He had projects for you, but ultimately, we heard about the villages. Of course, all we could think of was old people. But soon we visited, and when we got down here, all we heard about was pickleball. So, do you remember when you took us out on the pickleball court? If this is any indication of my level of coordination, Chris is right. It did not go well. I suffered in pain for the rest of the trip after falling, but anyway, eventually we bought a house here. Yeah. So, doesn't everybody? So anyway, fast forward 12 years, and here we are today. And you have been the most amazing servant, obedient to God, loving, tireless. And I think everybody here would join me in thanking you for all your service, your friendship, your love. It's been great. I'm excited to see what the future holds for you. I know God has more plans for both of you. But in the meantime, I hope that you can get back to your beloved Okoboji and have lots of rest and relaxation in the next few months. And we'll look forward to seeing you back here in the fall. We love you so much.
I'm going to read mine because otherwise it will just be like 2 seconds. I'll forget everything. I was asked to present you with a gift, and we've got a gift for you. And then they told me I had to say something, so it got a little harder. But anyway, so the saying, behind every successful man is a great woman, is especially true for Chris and Kathleen. If it wasn't for this remarkable woman, I'm not sure where we'd be as a church now. So Kathleen, I want to honor and brag about you for a minute. Yes, you are the supportive helpmate to Chris, encouraging him and being a sounding board for all the hard decisions that have been made, but you are also a force in your own right. Kathleen has faithfully and effectively devoted her life to this church. She has led women's ministries and many women's Bible studies. She has and is working on the Community Blessing Project, as well as working alongside me as a volunteer coordinator for Trinity Springs. She has hosted countless Let's Do Lunches, which is amazing to me, and is now volunteering weekly at a local prison. She has made it a point to reach out and chat with many of you, and amazingly, she remembers so many of your names and details of your lives, which at this stage of our life is a superhuman feat. Kathleen is one of the most gracious and flexible people I know. When plans change or Chris brings home an unexpected guest, Kathleen hardly bats an eye. She regroups and gets it done without complaint. And besides all the church stuff, she's a great mom and loving grandmother. God knew what he was doing when he brought Chris and Kathleen together, and together they have helped birth Live Oaks Community Church and nurtured it along into a thriving, vibrant, healthy church. And we are so grateful for that and for you. As you are about to take a much-deserved cruise vacation, we want to give you a small token gift of our appreciation for all you have done for this church. We will miss you a lot, but look forward to your return in 6 months to pick up with friends and continue your service here and to the Lord. And it's not a gag gift.
If this is the moment that we're honoring this woman, I suggest a standing ovation.
Amen. Yeah. As they say, behind every great man, there's a greater woman. Yeah, so fantastic, well-deserved, Kathy. Your heart and your love for Jesus and your love for people is an amazing example. So seen here as anyone that's come into your path, come across and had an opportunity to be with you, how blessed they've been. So it's awesome. And I know how you don't like all this, so I'm just feeding it in here. And Kathy, you are, oh no, okay. Well, congratulations. This will go well with your trip that you guys are going to go on here soon. All right. So now I'm going to bring up to the stage, I'm going to bring up Bill Hicks, Bill and Karen Lyon, and Judy Weeks. Please welcome to the stage. Here we go, Bill.
Thank you.
I think they're all on. I think, no, this one is not on. No, we turn that one on. There you go. This one is on. All right. So, Bill, what do you have for us tonight?
Well, I thought about what I would say, and it starts with a breakfast at Perkins on 441. And actually, it's 15 years tomorrow.
Wow.
2010, and it was an interesting breakfast. Our pastor, or one of our pastors from Green Bay, had come down, and he had told me that he had gotten in touch with Glenn Shriver, who was the district, Southeastern District, and that Bruce Redman, the church planner, was going to be there. So Marianne and I go and get ready, and then this guy named Chris Hulk shows up.
So first impressions, Chris walks in. Have you met Chris before this at all?
Never met him.
Never met him. So Chris and Kathleen come in.
No Kathleen.
Just no Kathleen.
No Kathleen. Not like Bob.
So you were 50-50 now. This was
yes.
like,
Yeah. And you know, I was just kind of taken by surprise. I'm like, who is this guy? And they, of course, Glenn introduced him, and he was said he was from the head office there in Minneapolis. And I went, whoa, we're just getting started, and they're bringing the head office down. That's a good thing.
Yeah.
But it was kind of love at first sight, I guess you'd say. Because I was really thrilled by the idea of Encore. Mm-hmm. You know, I thought that is really cool. And how will that fit so well with what we could do here in the Villages?
Yes.
So I'm thinking in my mind, Chris is down here. Maybe he'll come and join us. Mm-hmm. And, of course, he didn't. He became an advisor, and he helped us out. And you saw the picture of the meeting for his Encore group on the Lanai, and during that meeting, or sometime during that meeting, he was telling them that he was thinking maybe he was going to come to the Villages and get us started. And so after that meeting, he was over for a few more days. We went down to Disney and went to Epcot, and we're just walking around the flower festival and talking to him and everything, and saying, how you feeling about it? He said, I just don't know. I don't know. Feeling like, you know, maybe so, but if I just had a sign, and if you could put the sign up. That is the real thing.
Which you paid that sky writer to write.
That's, yeah. Well, it cost us a lot.
Yeah. It was worth it, yeah.
It was part of getting started, so. But I thought, duh, some kind of sign that is. Mm. And so after that.
That really happened.
Yeah.
This is not made up. I was walking Epcot looking for a sign, and that was the sky writing, so that pretty obvious.
It was a good thing. So then he had to convince Kathleen. Well, they had been praying for about 4 months. He had sent an email to Glenn and to Bruce Redmond and Marianne and I and said, I think maybe this is the place for us to get started, or help you get started anyway. And so we were excited about that, but we were waiting to see what would happen. You know, so anyway, Chris wanted to have Kathleen to spend some time in the Villages. So after Exponential, I guess it was, in April, Kathleen came down, and the two of them stayed at our house over the weekend. We were down in Orlando in a timeshare, and we came back, and I turned in my driveway and opened the garage door, and we see this other sign. Well, I stopped the car, put it in reverse, started out of the driveway, and Marianne said, what are you doing? I said, it says there, we're in. We're going to come back later. And she looked at me and said, silly, that means they're going to do the church. So I have just one present for you. Paul can hold this.
I've been saving this
for a long time.
All right. Thank you, Bill. What an incredible story. I mean, you guys, you and Marianne, having that vision back and seeing the potential here in the Villages and the need to bring the gospel.
We looked for a church, we really couldn't find one that was kind of fit with some of the E-Free churches that we'd been involved with. And there wasn't really an E-Free church close. There was one over in Leesburg and one up in Ocala. It seemed like a good fit.
Yeah. I'm kind of surprised because you're from Green Bay. So most likely a Packer fan, yeah?
And I found, yeah, I found out he was a Viking.
A Viking fan. How did that almost, work? Was there almost, any kind of struggle?
It almost messed the deal up. No, I'm kidding.
It was the Iowa in between that.
There we go. Yeah. Oh, I should have worn my green
shirt. He's
going
to be wearing those tonight, for sure, right? Yeah. Awesome. Well, let's continue on. Who wants to go next?
My name is Judy Weeks, and when we first heard, my husband and I first heard there might be an E-Free Church, we were excited. But then we heard it was going to be somebody named Chris Holk that might be interested, and we never heard of him. And so we were a little concerned because he came from Iowa. And we're from Minnesota, and we were told nothing good ever comes out of Iowa, so we weren't sure. Of course, I take that back because my husband told me 35W comes out of Iowa. Well, at any rate, it was a real wonderful experience. But I do want to just focus on Kathleen just for a moment. Because Kathleen had a vision too. You know, we've been talking about Chris a lot, but Kathleen is here and she had a vision too. And that was really for a women's ministry, but she wanted it simple, easy, not much work. But we were meeting in a bingo hall right then, and it was difficult to find anything to do. And so we knew, well, Kathleen knew we had to do something. So she enlisted Karen Lyon and myself, and we were going to start this women's ministry, but we had to go look. And so we decided that was a good excuse, so we got in my convertible and put the top down, and away we went. We went east and we went west, and we found a couple of venues. So just so you know, Kathleen likes to ride in convertibles and let her hair blow. So anyway, we had a good time, and look at the women's ministry today, so thank you for that. It was great, it was great. Chris had an idea early on that he needed some help, and so he created PLT, which means Provisional Leadership Team. Now, I questioned the provisional part because that means temporary or not so good, and I wasn't sure I wanted to be a part of that team. So I'm thinking that maybe if you're going to use that again, you might want to think about, like, productive, really personal, maybe perfect leadership team. Okay, will that work for you? Because that, you know, for those of us that have an insecurity problem, that would be good. Okay. That PLT had a lot of difficult things to deal with, and the number one thing was actually communion cups. That was a tough deal we had to work through. And my dear friend down here, Betty Augustine, was our champion. She was on that team, and without her, we'd have been lost. Because she helped Chris understand communion cups. Now, when he did have a little problem, and the first problem was, if you can picture, he's standing up here all pastor-like, and he's standing here behind the communion table, and there's a whole line of men that are waiting to serve the communion to all the people. And he picks up the cup, and he's going to quote scripture, and he looks down and he says to himself, I'm sure he did. Some of this is true and some is exaggerated, but that's okay. He looks and he says, I got a problem. And he says to the men in front of him, he thought in a whisper, but it woke up the guy in the back row. He says, where's the bread? He couldn't find the bread in the communion cup. Fortunately, the men knew where the bread was, and so they told him, and he got that settled. And then Betty stepped in and gave him communion cups 101 all over again, right? And you got it figured out. There was one other problem with communion that he had, because that seemed to be the major issue we were dealing with in the PLT meetings those times. And that was, again, he was up here doing the getting the communion ready, and not really counting how many trays there were that needed to be distributed. He reached down to grab what he thought was two trays, but there was three there, and so his hand didn't go all the way. And from what I'm understanding, it was a loud clatter when the third one dropped from his hand right onto the table. Is that correct?
I don't want to admit that.
Oh, he doesn't want to admit that. But that too, you know, that woke up a few people that time, more than just one. But he did manage to get through that, and so we finally got the communion issue settled. Well, we went on from there, and he knew he was working with older folks, and he kind of wondered about us, I believe, because he started talking about being old. And I wasn't real impressed with somebody who thought I was old. That made me a little bit upset. But then he went on to say, if you're not dead, we've heard that a couple of times, and he tended to say it over and over, so we kind of realized that he really meant it. So we understood that piece. But I wanted to tell you that one thing he did is he also knew how to party. And in that bingo hall, we had a strobe light, a crystal ball that he insisted stay there. And we had a party there. And the music started up, and the tempo started, and guess who led the dance floor team? Those two right over there led it out to the dance floor, dancing under that strobe light. They know how to party. You know, you got to have some R&R when you're doing things, right? And so we're grateful for that. We're grateful for all the sides that we saw of Pastor Chris and Kathleen as we grew together, in this venture called Live Oaks Church. It's been a blessing. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say that Pastor Chris loves his flock. He really loves his people. And I experienced that personally when my husband passed away, because he was able to help us through that. And he officiated at the service, and he even sang, which I was grateful for. And then he flew up to Minnesota to be up there with us, too. So I learned firsthand about Pastor Chris and Kathleen caring for their flock. So thank you for that. God bless you both. Love you.
All right, Bill and Karen, are you ready?
We're ready.
All right.
We've been waiting for this.
Ooh, that has a little bit of a...
Chris, Kathleen, there's so many stories we could tell. You know that. But we'll try to be brief and more accurate.
She's looking at me, folks. Just because I forgot to do something. I have to go back when we're done because I forgot to do it.
We first met Chris where? He invited us to meet him. Not at the church office, because there wasn't one, at the back of Starbucks. Not at the front, at the back. There's a cute little place back there, Starbucks. And Bill and I were searching for a church. We had been in three other church plants. We weren't necessarily looking for a church plant. In fact, not necessarily. We were not looking for a church plant. But we had seen the article in the paper, and we were kind of, Bill mentioned it, that maybe this might be some place where we would be better suited, better qualified, better sermons, better everything. So we knew, we had heard of the nomination, but we just weren't sure. Anyway, we met with Chris, and we talked quite a while with him, and... He wanted to know more about our background, and when we said we had planted churches, his, you know, antennas kind of went up, I think. We talked for quite a while, and we told him we would get back to him. He said, well, wait, my wife is coming. He actually brought his wife to Starbucks. We should have known then, right? So...
The closer.
The closer. Kathleen came, we met, we sat for a while longer. And as we walked back to the car after our meeting, we turned to one another and we said, I'll call him when I get home. So that was our first meeting with them. But all the time that we've been at Live Oaks here, I have to say that Chris is a man of many hats. I think if you look across up here, you might see a few of his hats that we found. Not just one hat, not just two hats. Hat after hat after hat after hat. all kinds of hats. Ball caps. I don't know what that other hat's called.
Nice fedora up there. Yeah.
Fedora.
That's his Cuban stage,
yeah,
you know.
That's his Cuban hat, yeah. You notice Kathleen never has a hat or a visor on. But you notice the grandkids don't have hats on. But Chris has a hat on. Hat after hat after hat. I flip through the pictures. Hats, hats, hats. But we found out at the church why he wore hats. It wasn't because of the cul-de-sac on his head, but he was a man.
I thought that was it. We couldn't speak about that tonight.
Never thought of that. But he was a man of many hats at the church. You could find Chris doing all kinds of situations at the church as it first began. He was out gardening, pulling weeds. He was helping clean up when we moved into the first building that we were in. He was right there with everybody cleaning, vacuuming, shoveling, whatever needed to be done. And that's what inspired us so much about Chris, that it didn't matter what needed to be done. If he was there and he was able, he would do it. And we appreciate that about you, Chris, that you worked right alongside of us. Mm-hmm. You weren't just directing us, but you were working with us. But there's a couple special hats. Are we through with the hats? There we go. Here's my special hat. Here's the farmer boy in his John Deere hat.
Pioneer Seed Corn.
Pioneer Seed Corn.
Okay, that's close enough. Here's our farmer boy, but here is our illustrious pastor.
Move it along.
He even has a Live Oak shirt on. I thought that was interesting in this wonderful hat. I don't even remember the story behind this, but it popped up. So we appreciate that you're a man of many hats. But one other thing I want to talk about is Chris, as you know, he loves to gather with people. He loves to celebrate. And when we, at the beginning of the church, when it was a little smaller, he would host a breakfast. Was it Memorial Day?
Fourth of July
breakfast. And we were all invited to a breakfast at their house. They opened up their house and had this wonderful breakfast. Little did we know that there was a special reason he invited us to that breakfast. I have here a few little things that I received from Hormel. It was a spam breakfast. Now, who serves their guest ham? We thought that was the funniest thing. Hormel thought it was neat that I called them that you were retiring. They sent you some spam cards, and some spam sunglasses.
That's right. Don't knock it till you fry
it. Most of all, a spam crying towel.
Thank you, brother. Now, Bill, there was a lot that was spoken there. Do you have some also?
Yeah, Judy's got a closing piece to what she has.
Yeah, you know, women forget things, but we got a second chance, right? So we were concerned because we thought you might lose a little bit of the incentive, the you're not dead, you're not done thing, and you might want to use it later on. And so I do have this from the PLT team to help you. It's a book, and it's called If You're Not Dead, You're Not Done. It's got a lot of ideas in here for you. So when you get older, like the rest of us, you'll find out some new ideas for you, okay?
All right.
Well, we've talked quite a bit about play hard, pray hard, finish well. I'm going to take this to a more serious note now. We've had play hard, pray hard, finish well in front of us for all of the years that we've been here, but it started out as just
play hard, pray hard, based upon a T-shirt Chris had, and I've actually seen that phrase in a couple of the pictures that we showed up on top. But you need to recognize that, excuse me, Chris has always... Chris has always been a pretty good athlete. And this is my interpretation of play hard. Chris was a great softball player as well as a golfer, pickleballer. He does all kinds of good stuff like that. He was playing in a game where his body at 50 thought it could function like it did at 20, and he dove for this ball and ended up being in the hospital for a better part of a week with what the doctors described as a fractured kidney. Yeah, it was a pretty serious time for our pastor, all because of what you see here.
I stopped the ball. I made the play.
I know you did, but I didn't want to give them the wrong impression by my picture.
Well, and so. Bill in Austin, when he played softball, he took one to the eye pitching and seven stitches for that too. And he also stopped the ball on that one.
So needless to say, his softball career has ended. But so as a memento of that, here is a absolute perfect picture of that great ball stoppage hospital trip event. So thank you, Chris. Thank you. Good planning. So this was play hard. He does it a little more intensely than most of us might do, but he takes it serious. And as our pastor, I am taking it serious too, that we need to be engaged in what's going on. The second part of this was pray hard. We've learned about how this piece of land came to us, and that was through prayer, but there is a picture. So check this one out. There's a group of us praying on this particular land before this building was built. This was a cow pasture, tall grass, and we had to shoo the cows off in order to get enough space to pray over this land to make sure that it would happen. Since it was a cow pasture, we often had to come out here in advance of that and sort of tidy up a bit. So check out this picture. Yeah, so you can imagine what that might look like if you, well, no, you can't. But so we were out here making sure that the area was decent enough for us to come out here in small groups and to pray on this land for this building that we didn't know was going to be here yet. But so through the technology and science of the world, we were able to resurrect one of those items. And it has an expiration date, but it's been aged more than 10 years. So we would like to present this to you as a memento of how much we pray hard here at Live Oaks Community Church.
I think you just warm it up in the microwave.
So it was manufactured on the date of that picture, and it has an expiration date, which is April 1, 2024. So my recommendation to you that if you intend to open it, you have a very well-ventilated room, and I would suggest you be by yourself. I don't know that I would want anybody else to be contaminated by that.
I enjoyed everything else.
Good, that was the plan. All right. So now we're down to finish well. What does that look like? Well, we took a while to actually settle on that phrase, finish well. And I think we've settled on it for a good reason, because we want to reach the end doing everything that God has asked us to do, perhaps in a tattered, worn, beat up old body when we slide underneath the pearly gates. We're going to finish well. Well, in a staff meeting, we often recognize the visionary talents of our pastor. He sees way out in front. He knows, he understands what God wants him to go, where he wants him to go, and what he wants him to accomplish. And he is amazing at that, with that talent, with that gift. Now, we as the staff define Chris as the engineer of our train. So check out this one. So he's the engineer of this train heading down this track at I don't know how many miles per hour. And the staff is out front furiously laying the track so we can get to where he needs to go. So that was sort of the way we worked as a staff, is he had the vision, he was driving the train, we were laying the superstructure, the structure down below it. So we made it work, we've gotten here, look where we are today. His vision, all of our energy. So as a reminder of that, we have one other last little item, which is as you're driving your train into the station for this last phase, this is a memento of your journey as our engineer on this train called Live Oaks Community Church. So it's a great little memento for him and his journey. So thank you for letting me pick on you. Enjoy your time.
All right, is that everything, or do we have one more, Bill?
Just got one more
thing.
That's
what I thought, yes.
And I want to also say one more thing. We've joked a lot about how God is our heavenly headhunter, but he began with the two of you. I think you were created for this. I think this church would not be what it is without you. I look forward to where we go moving forward. I think it's exciting what we have in the future. But thank you for what you did getting us started.
So what we have here, thank you, you all, big round of thanks. So what we have here, you guys want to describe out what you're seeing here?
Wow, I think I have volume 2, but I'm not sure who's the scrapbooker here because not
wow.
me, but I am looking at pictures. I am looking at letters from people here, from Don and Carmen Lockman, and it goes on, Jody and Steve, and we are going to have so much fun reading all of these. It's letters after letters. So I can't tell you. I'm just looking at this. Dear Chris and Kathleen, Dave and Donlin, Chuck and Rosemary, Dick and Shirley, Debbie Huntley. Oh my goodness.
So that's why they gave you the luggage, so you can bring those on the cruise ship with you and have good reading time on the deck.
Wonderful, wonderful gift. Wonderful. Thank you.
Well, there's truly no other way to elevate this occasion than to sing of the one for whom Chris and Kathleen have chosen to commit their life to. Let's stand as we sing. The grave.
of all blessing and honor and glory. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of thee? He is, he is. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? He is, he is, he
is. Thank you, Steve. Chris and Kathy, why don't you come back up? I'm going to invite Bob Orloff out here. He is coming on out now to present you. We're going to come through this narrow passage. We got it. But we'll come out this way here. Here we go. Bill?
I think it's appropriate that they let the serious elder present this. Because this is pretty nice. One thing I wanted to say, how many people have played golf with Chris? Wow. Well, I was able to play with him when he first came here. And I didn't make the cut because we haven't played again. That's right, I did, didn't I? Anyway, I hope that now with your semi-retirement, we'll be able to occasionally play. Well, this gift is a rock. And I know we had a rock missing from outside the church that someone borrowed, but this one is going to be pretty heavy, and I don't think they'll be able to take this. And this is your life verse, 1 Peter 2:21. To this you were called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps.
Now, Chris, what I heard the story behind this rock is that it was a rock that was out front and it mysteriously disappeared, maybe.
Well, there's a rock that disappeared. This wasn't the one.
This is
an incredible gift. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, hey, let's take a chance now. We're going to look back in pictures over the years of your ministry. So we can sit back, relax, and enjoy.
There's a call going out across the land in every nation. A call to all who swear allegiance to the cross of Christ. A call to true humility, to live our lives responsibly, to deepen our devotion to the cross at any price. Let us then be sober, moving only in the Spirit, as aliens and strangers in a hostile foreign land. The message we're proclaiming is repentance and forgiveness, the offer of salvation to the dying race of man. To love the Lord. shine, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission. As a candle is consumed by the passion of the flame, spilling light unsparingly throughout a darkened room, let us burn to know him deeper than our service flaming bright. We'll radiate his passions and blaze with holy light.
Holy light.
To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name. To love the Lord our God is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service overflows. Across the street or around the world, the mission's still the same. Proclaim and live the truth in Jesus' name.
The Lord our God
is the heartbeat of our mission, the spring from which our service
for you guys. Some thoughts as you guys look back at over all the years of ministry. Josh, could you help? Oh, no, we got it.
Well, thank you. That's, I have to get over that, because that is, like Laura said, her whole lifetime we've been in ministry. And there just aren't many pastors that are able to smile at the end of their ministry and say, we loved it. We have. God has been so good. He has been a hedge of protection around us. And he has brought people around us that have fueled the mission that he set us on. I've really adopted a phrase, and it needs to be said. I get complimented so often as a visionary, but a visionary without partners is just a dreamer. And your partners. Kathleen has been a partner all those years, and clearly, our ministry has been a two-for-one, and so I'm so grateful for what we've done together by the grace of God. thank you all for being here today. This is very honoring. Thank you, elders, for making sure that this moment didn't pass by without an opportunity to celebrate. And I do like to celebrate. I think I like to celebrate because forgetting what God has done is a sin. Because when we forget, our faith is likely to erode. But when we remember and we celebrate who He is and what He's done, it's a faith builder. And so, yeah, I like to celebrate. And this has been an incredible celebration. So thank you.
I didn't think I was going to say anything. That the video, so my joy was looking back for 38 years and actually longer, as you saw some farm pictures and that. But as I did this, I couldn't help but say thank you, Lord, for the blessings in our life. And I'm very grateful that God chose Chris Hulk to be my husband. I probably could have had a dull life and stayed in Chicago. But I went for the ride, and God chose us to do this together. And so I am very grateful, and I'm honored for these 12 years to be your pastor's wife. And truly, we do love you, and it has been such a privilege to serve here. And so I can't say that enough. To all of you, I wish I could say individually that. So again, thank you from the bottom of my heart. And again, that video is a little bit, I chose the song, which was sung by Steve Green. And that just is very interesting that you didn't notice, but also that song was sung at Chris's ordination. So it's all come around, and the words are really beautiful, and it kind of expresses my heart, and I think our heart as ministry. So I love you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So with regard to future, I'm again very grateful that the elders and you, the congregation, have given us the opportunity to continue to serve here. And so we will be away for the summer. We're going to be here the next couple weeks. I'll be preaching sunrise service next Sunday, which is a great joy for me. We'll be here a couple weeks, sort of wrapping things up, and then we'll be away for 6 months. But when we return in the fall, we're going to continue to serve. We love you and this church and this community, and we want to do everything we can to strengthen it. So I'll be preaching some and leading some different kinds of ministry initiatives here, and we'll just be us, which means we'll be hanging out in the commons and getting to know folks and, you know, strengthening the relationships we already have. And if you didn't raise your hand that I played golf with you, let's get that on the agenda as well. I'm so pleased today that I've been able to finish a book. You saw a book there that I wrote in 2016, and I've just refreshed it. A lot's happened here since 2016. And so I refreshed that book, and writing a book is a lot of work, so it feels great to be to the finish line. I'm indebted to some people that really helped me get there. But as you leave today, there's a copy for each of you to take. It's the story of this church. It's the story of what God has done here. And I had a front row seat for that entire time. And I've just tried to chronicle that, lest we forget Let's celebrate what God has done. So I hope you enjoy it. It's a story that a few of you have seen unfold, but many of you who have come since we got our start, praise the Lord that you're here. It'll fill in some of the gaps of how God brought this church to be as mature it is as it is today. So our gift to you, and thank you.
Amen. Well, you've been a huge inspiration to all of us, but the one question people are really wondering about was, who's your favorite youth pastor? No? Oh.
It's not hard to answer that, Paul.
It's not?
You're the man.
Oh, thank you, Chris. Chris has had an incredible influence on my family. We met in 1997. We met in a small town in Minnesota in a hotel. We had some chicken and talked over what the future could possibly look like. We didn't know what to make, but when I got to meet Chris, it changed our lives. I mean, God used Chris to do something incredible, as he's done with all of so many people that's come in his life, and all of you, that there's just something that God has, just gifts that Chris has been, endowed with, but him making me a better man today, a better pastor, a better husband, a better father, more competitive, and Chris is the biggest apologist for the Villages. When he talks about spiritually transformed disciples, that's really what the Villages is all about. Take the letters, not the other thing. That aspect of really his love for not only spreading the gospel all across the world, but just his love for you. And we get to meet up with Chris and Kathy every few months and have dinner and get to hear all how much they love you guys and what an incredible turnout it is today. So thank you for letting me be part of this and to celebrate you. You guys well deserve all the accolades. So with that, why don't we all stand together?
Excellent. Let's stand. There's no greater way to finish out today than to sing of the goodness of God. It's certainly been evident in Chris and Kathleen's life and in ours as well. If you're visiting with us today, you're going to hear how this congregation loves to sing. Been held in your
been asked to wrap this all up, and so it's my good privilege to also say thank you to Chris and Kathleen. We didn't know each other, and then you took me in when I was a widower, and God just used you to bless my life so much. And you have been so important in my life in the last 11 years. And I just can't thank you enough. I hope that your next 10, your next 11 years will be as good and sweet as mine have been with you. I just thank you so much. And since you are the fashion diva, 11 and a half years ago, you came to my farewell. It was a living room setting up in Illinois, and you gave me a gift. And I am going to give it back to you. I've never worn it.
Really?
Looks much better on him than it ever would on me. And so, thank you. I've been asked to close this time with a prayer of thanksgiving and blessing of Chris and Kathleen. I'd like their family, if they would come around, Chris and Kathleen, and lay hands on them. Incidentally, this is the appropriate bag for you as well. It says party animal. So, would you all bow with me in prayer? Father, we are not saying goodbye. We know we're going to be seeing each other again. And so we just want to stop and just say thank you. Thank you for raising Chris and Kathleen up for such a time as this. You somehow embedded into their hearts this great, great love and appreciation for the Encore generation, the baby boomers and beyond. And you taught them so much even before they got here, preparing them to be able to lead a very, very unique and special congregation that you assembled together and have continued to assemble. You taught Chris and Kathleen how to value and appreciate the culture of this area where we are active senior adults who are seeking to give you the very best of our lives at the end of our lives. And so, Father, thank you. We have all been so enriched. We have been blessed. We have spiritually grown. We've been tested through all of the ministry that they have led us in. There are times when their vision far surpassed our faith, and then we caught up with them. And we just thank you, Father, for that. And Lord, we just ask your sweetest and best blessing upon them for these next 10, 11, 12, beyond years. We pray, Father, that you would give them great health, that you would keep them madly in love with each other as we know they are, that you would find for them and open up to them new worlds, new possibilities, to be able to use their extraordinary gifts in some new and fresh, but always God-honoring ways. And bless their family. Bless each one of their children, their grandchildren. We pray, Father, for the blessing on their marriages and on their families, Lord. And Father, we pray that the best still is yet to come for them. We thank you that as a congregation, we've been able to celebrate with them lives so well lived in our presence. Lord, we love them, And we continue to place them in your hands for the work you have next for them. Bless them, Lord. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for coming tonight.